Welcome to this service this evening. Tonight and tomorrow night are services of shadows. They act as a discipline in acknowledging Christ's suffering, a prolonged meditation on his darkest hours. These are both services of grief, and thankfully we do not grieve as those who have no hope. However, in these services we honor Christ's request to stay with him in his hour of suffering. Services of shadows got their name organically. Before there was electricity, as each candle was blown out, the shadows would deepen in the sanctuaries until the congregation at the end of the service, at the end of the shadows, was left in darkness. We will worship through three shadows tonight and two remaining shadows tomorrow night. And our service tonight will end in silence and end in darkness. So let's worship God.
Thank you. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Let us pray. O Lord, during this time of holy worship, may your Spirit descend upon us, reminding us anew of the sacrifices of our Savior. We pray that in this knowledge, we would be empowered to make our own sacrifices to build your kingdom in this world. We offer this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing our first song. It is printed in your bulletin. Please remain standing and let us pray together the prayer of confession. It is printed in our bulletins. Let us pray. Eternal God, whose covenant with us is never broken, we confess that we fail to fulfill your will. Though you have bound yourself to us, we fail to bind ourselves to you. We do not love you fully or love one another as you command. In your mercy, forgive and cleanse us. Lead us once again to your table and unite us to Christ, who is the bread of life and the true vine from which we grow in grace. Amen. My friends, who is in a position to condemn? It is only Christ. Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone, the new life has come. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Let's sing to God's glory. Be seated. The shadow of loneliness. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then Jesus said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away for a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners."
Thank you.
There was bread on that table that night. We know there was bread, and there was wine. Those are the two things that we remember that we talk about, but we know there was more than that on the table. There was also lamb and eggs and herbs. They were celebrating the Passover. It was a full table. And we also know what was on the table, because it was always on the table. It was a part of every meal. What would have also been on the table was olive oil. It's a staple of their diet then. It's a staple of their diet now. And the way it's been made, actually, the way it's been made hasn't really changed for thousands of years. The olives were crushed by millstones, crushed until they lost all their recognizable form. They were this paste, and then the paste was spread thin onto mats, and the mats stacked and pressed until, with the water mixed in, the water would sink and the oil would rise. The first press of oil, of olives, was at a lower temperature, and so it made the finest oil. It was oil that was considered holy only for use in the temple, in worship. Today we call it extra virgin olive oil. That's the first press in the olive press. But when you're pressing olives, you aren't done. There's a second press, and you raise the temperature to get more out of it. You heat things up and you press, but this one is not as quality as the first. It was not for holy things. It was for health and for eating, for medicine, for food, and we just call it virgin olive oil today. And that's the second press. And then just when you would think that olives couldn't give anything more, there is a third pressing. You aren't done until the third press. There's almost nothing left, no nutrients. But this third pressing is so that nothing will go to waste. They would use it for safety, for light, to use it in oil lamps. We call it just olive oil. And that is the third press. Oil would have been on the table that night, and it wasn't just on the table. Oil, olive oil, is at the center of what's happening. Jesus is in the center of the oil press, the olive press. Literally, he's in the center of it. When we say he's in the Garden of Gethsemane praying, he's in the Garden of the Olive Press. That's what Gethsemane means. The Garden of the Olive Press. Picture him there when he is weeping and praying and begging his friends. Millstones and mats would have been laid out nearby. That's what happened in that garden, was pressing, pressing, pressing. And Matthew wants us to make sure we don't forget that. He tells us that three times Jesus sought the support of his friends, a first press, a second press, a third. Three times he seeks out his friends and they are asleep. Matthew tells us that three times he prayed to God his Father. Anything but this, he prayed. Anything but this. Three times. We are told that Jesus was so upset that he fell on his face. He fell on his face in the dirt when he prayed like this. We read words that sound a little bit lofty, like he was sorrowful and troubled, but that doesn't do his feelings justice. The words mean anguish. They mean stunned and confused and overwhelmed and wishing he could die right then. That pressure that Jesus is under. Three times he did this. Three times he threw himself to the ground in prayer, pressed and pressed and pressed. I want you to picture him there. Picture him in that garden of the olive press. Does it scare you to see him so vulnerable? Do you desire a more stoic savior? If it does, and if you do, please not tonight. Not tonight. Let's not make what is happening here any easier than it was. Not tonight. Jesus came to us both fully divine and fully human, and he is being crushed until he is unrecognizable. Three times, the process continues. He asks for his friends to stay, and they cannot. He falls to the ground in prayer. And each of the three times, the process ends the very same way. You heard Phil read it. It ends with Jesus praying, "Not my will, but your will be done." Three times. In the pressure that heats up more each time, three times he ends the cycle with obedience. Not what I want, but what you want. Not what I want, but what you want. As we watch, as you watch him there, what you are watching is you are watching our Lord arch himself, bend himself steadily, steadily to the will of God. And even for him, it is painful. As a preacher, it would usually now be my pattern to say to each of you, let's be more like Jesus. Let's learn from him so that when we are pressed, when we face our own Garden of Gethsemane, we will also be obedient. And I could say that to you tonight, and it would be good, and it would be faithful. But tonight, for tonight, let's not do that. Not just yet. Not just yet. Not as we see him in Gethsemane, in the press. Tonight, let's simply worship him. Let's simply be in awe of him. When he was crushed, his face in the dirt, pressed beyond measure, and crying out in anguish, he was obedient. Not my will, but your will be done. So tonight, let us be in awe of him. Let us honor him with respectful stillness. Let us worship our Lord. Amen.
My friends, the table of bread and wine is now to be made ready. It's the table of company with Jesus and all who love him. It's the table of sharing with the poor of the world, with whom Jesus identified himself. It's the table of communion with the earth, in which Christ became incarnate. So come to this table, you who have much faith and you who would like to have more. you who have been here often, and you who have not been here for a long time, you who have tried to follow Jesus, and you who have failed, come. It's Christ who invites us to meet him here. Let us pray. O Lord, we thank you for the gift of this table, for the gift of bread and of cup, for the gift of renewal in our lives of faith, for the gift of your presence in the midst of this world, for the gift of your Holy Spirit, which transforms us, strengthens us, and renews us. As we come to this table, as we gather around it, as we receive these gifts, which you have passed down to us over the ages, help us to come here not merely as individuals, but as friends, as family, as brothers and sisters to one another. That through these elements, our relationship with one another might be renewed as our relationship with you is vitalized. We offer this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you now to listen to the story of our faith. Not that. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it. He said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup. He said, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, for the remission of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. For every time you eat this bread and drink from this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Tonight we'll be having communion by intinction. We will invite you down, starting from the back of the sanctuary, then towards the front. We invite you to take a piece of bread and a cup, return to your seats, hold those elements, and we will all eat and drink together as one people. I would also remind you that this is not a Presbyterian table. It's the table of Jesus Christ, and everybody who believes in him is welcome at this table. Will the servers come forward?
Thank you.
The body of Christ broken for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. O Lord, we come before you always mindful of the beauty and the sorrow that are held in this world, the beauty of relationships, of love, of the giving and receiving of grace, of kindness, of mercy, of gentleness, the beauty of creation, the sorrows of loss, of violence, of war, of rage, anger, and hatred. We come before you holding both of these things in our hearts and offering them now to you in silent prayer. Holy Lord, we know that you hear all of our prayers. We offer them to you this day in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The shadow of desertion. While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him. Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and he kissed him. Jesus replied, "Do what you came for, friend." Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. With that, one of Jesus' companions reached for his sword, drew it out, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said to him. "For all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that they say it must happen in this way?" In that hour, Jesus said to the crowd, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I sat in the temple courts teaching, and you did not arrest me. But this has all taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him, and they all fled.
Thank you.
shadow of accusation and denial. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of the law and the elders had assembled, but Peter followed Jesus at a distance. Right up to the courtyard of the high priest, he entered and sat down with the guards to see the outcome. The high priest said to Jesus, "I charge you under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God." "You have said so," Jesus replied, "but I say to all of you, from now on you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming in the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and he said, "He has spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, now you have heard his blasphemy. What do you think?" "He is worthy of death," they answered. Now Peter was sitting out in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him. "You also were with Jesus of Galilee," she said. But he denied it before them all. "I don't know what you're talking about," Peter said. Then he went out to the gateway where another servant girl saw him and said to the people there, "This fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth." He denied it again with an oath, "I don't know the man." After a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, "Surely you are one of them. Your accent gives you away." Then Peter began to call down curses, and he swore to them, "I don't know the man." Immediately a rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had spoken, "Before the rooster crows, you will disown me 3 times. And Peter went outside and wept bitterly. The service is not over. It continues tomorrow night at 6 p.m. and then culminates on Easter Sunday. Please go in silence and go in peace.